In this video, we're going to be talking about modpacks. If you guys didn't see, about a week ago, I made a video discussing an incredible new mod for Fallout, Skyrim, and technically even many other games that with Wabbajack. Although calling it a mod, it's really more of a tool that allows users to actually set up modpacks for certain games. So with just a few clicks, you could have literally everything you want downloaded, patched, extracted, and pretty much all of the steps taken care of. So you just do a few things, but then can play heavily modded Skyrim or Fallout 4, such as what you're seeing in the background. One of the caveats around this is you actually need Nexus Premium to unlock this auto download feature. This to offset the lack of ads you're going to see through the auto download while they still have to host all those files on their servers. And frankly, it's only $4 and I would gladly pay $4 to save several hours of time. If you actually do the math, it works out pretty well in your favor. As far as how much it took for me to actually get some of this stuff working, you're talking maybe 20 minutes, if that. There are several notable updates around this that I did want to share in this video. First and foremost, as I kind of alluded to in my initial one, I imagined as that tool got more popular, there'd be some drama surrounding it, people pulling mods, mod pack authors getting mad. I do want to discuss some of that. I think it is a worthy discussion to be had. But even further, on the positive side for users, several additional mod packs have actually come out. And there's a couple of interesting things around this. First and foremost, just some cool ones for those of you that want ultra modded experience in Fallout, Skyrim, or even other games now. But even further, for those of you that like modding Fallout or Skyrim yourselves, there's also options for you. This was another concept I discussed in my original video, but now it's not just a concept, you could actually experience it. So in this video, I'm going to be going over all of that as well as some other things like the future of the tool itself. If you enjoy the content, you can leave a like or subscribe. I'd love to hit 500,000 subscribers by the end of the year. But first, and almost in a way to get this out of the way, to end the video on a more positive note, let's talk about some of the drama that has arose following the release of Wabbajack. Again, I mentioned this in my original video. There are pros and cons to tools like this. There are certainly people kind of losing out or on the downside when a mod pack comes out. For the users, sometimes it's hard to sympathize with that because for the users, it's pretty great. There really aren't too many downsides, but for the mod authors or even mod pack creators, there are. So since the tool's release, we've seen a couple of things. One of the available mod packs was Yash. This is a long-withstanding mod pack for Skyrim. It's a very hefty mod pack. It's one of the more popular ones, but also one of the larger ones available out there. You've probably seen these before. It's basically just a mod pack guide, per se, walking you through nicely step by step as to what you have to do to actually achieve Skyrim with several hundred mods. And for some of these guides, the author actually ends up creating their own custom content to make everything work together, such as was the case with this particular guide. Well, somebody who was totally separate from the mod guide's creator actually created an adaption of this for Wabbajack. So in just a couple of steps and a lot of time to let the downloads process, you could have this full experience added to your Skyrim. There were several steps involved, but it wasn't nearly on the level or to the degree that it would be to do it manually, which is a very lengthy process even while following the guide. Following this, the guide was actually pulled from Nexus along with some of those patch mods. There were statements issued around this by both Yasht as well as Wabbajack in response. I'm going to put the full statements on screen. You could pause if you want to read them, but for sake of time, I'll paraphrase. The guide on Nexus was basically hidden because the author was never consulted. The auto installer was created without their permission, and them feeling like they don't have power or don't have the permission pulled the guide. They felt like Wabbajack was advertising using the tools via these popular guides. And the official Wabbajack response is basically that this is just a tool using some of the rights made available by the Nexus Terms of Service, and that he's not changing his position on this issue because the Skyrim modding community needs to get past this mod pack debacle. He's hoping that some of this backlash or controversy will solve this issue once and for all and not go back to the previous status quo. And really, to break it down, this issue kind of focuses or centers around the Nexus API. Technically, by using or taking advantage of the Nexus API, you could create these auto download tools. That's an option put there by Nexus. It's not like mod pack creators are creating some crazy workaround. Hypothetically, there could be a opt-out option for mod pack authors that aren't interested in this, but Nexus doesn't currently provide that. The Yasht guide still does exist for Wabbajack. Now it's a mod pack based on Yasht, and of course received some updates following this. That was really the first casualty around this. A secondary one are some of Demanding's mods, the most popular of which is definitely Creative Clutter. These are being pulled from Nexus Genesis on September 27th, so a week from today, and now will just be a Bethesda.net exclusive. The main reason given for this, again, is that lack of an opt-out feature. Let's say you created a mod, posted on Nexus, and somebody wants to add that mod to their mod pack, but you don't want them to, there's no automatic way to prevent that. You'd have to go manually and ask them, hey, can you stop using that? And of course, they could say no, technically, but the only real solution being that you pull the mod from Nexus overall. That was definitely the main point, but she has an entire write-up on some of the other points around this, some of the other major themes being that there's a lack of quality control with mod packs. There are certain mod pack authors actually locking mod packs behind paywalls. Although a note on that, due to the license being used by Wabbajack, you technically can't legally do that. Although you could ask for donations, if somebody said, hey, I would like this mod pack, you technically have to give it to them for free, but there's no necessary way to enforce that. So even though that's technically the truth, we'll see how it actually plays out. Although as of right now, none of the Wabbajack mod packs are actually locked behind paywalls. And of course, none of the officially supported ones seemingly will ever be locked behind paywalls. So naturally, we knew this kind of thing was going to happen. As I mentioned in my original video, there definitely is some concern around there not being an opt-out functionality. It seems pretty clear now that most people, users of course, but also mod authors, actually support and want mod packs for Skyrim and Bethesda modding overall. A recent poll ran by Nexus had results where 35% of mod authors saw this as very positive, 40% positive, 16% neutral, and only 5% negative, and 3.5% very negative. So really, as far as opposition goes, based on this singular poll, it's only at 8.7%. We know Nexus in the coming months or years has a plan for their own take on mod packs. We don't know too much about that, but it'll be curious and interesting to see how this is implemented. Yeah, at least thus far, I'm actually kind of surprised there hasn't been more backlash around this. I think to a degree, this is a conversation that needs to be had. I think mod packs overall are a good thing for Bethesda modding. It makes it more approachable, it makes it more appealing to the masses, but at the same time, there certainly could be revisions on the current version that would improve it. Which, speaking of, there actually have been some changes to Wabbajack since I originally covered it. There's additional tutorials and a new install video if you want to check that out. Now, as you're actually going to install a list of mods, you could check out what that mod list actually is and have links to all of the Nexus posts around this. And as far as some of the future or planned updates, they're going to add support for FOMOD and OMOD, very good for Oblivion installers. A way to automatically download and install mods from other websites, such as Patreon and Lover's Lab, although that one will be a little bit more hands-on with whoever posted the mod on those websites, as well as the installation is actually going on, some kind of mod slideshow to entertain the users and actually drive more traffic to some of the sites they're pulling mods from. There have also been several new mod pack additions with this latest update that will probably be of interest to you. We've seen an expansion overall in the types of games that are supported. In my original video, it was really only Fallout and Skyrim, but since then, we've actually gotten mod lists for Fallout New Vegas, some for Oblivion, quite a few additional ones for Skyrim Special Edition. On the New Vegas side of things, you've probably heard about the very popular mod guide known as Fear and Loathing. Well, the author of that, Gamer Poets, has actually started adapting that to Wabbajack. So right now there's an auto installer for New Vegas that can kind of act as a base. This is using Gamer Poets' stability guide, and it's basically going to bring you, as you probably guess, all the stability improvements you'd hope to see with this. This is unique in that it's not really meant to be a complete modded experience. If you just wanted to play New Vegas in a very vanilla way, then it would be. This will act as a base, giving you better FPS, better performance, less crashing, and then the idea being you start to install some of your own mods over top of it. There's also a separate guide being created for Viva La Vegas. This is another fairly popular mod pack, a little bit more updated. That one's also broken up into modules, a stability module similar to Fear and Loathing, but also a gameplay module actually impacting and changing the gameplay. On the other side of things, we also had a very similar thing for Skyrim Special Edition, kind of an essential mod pack. This being dubbed Modless Lite, what it's going to do is give you all those essential fixes, the unofficial patches, and some of the other stuff like alternate start or sky UI that you probably download and install every single time you start a new load order, but maybe don't want to go through the process this time. You could just use this tool and then start to build off that original list. So again, those are two options for those of you that enjoy the intricate part of modding this game, don't want just one and done download installer for everything, but maybe for the more tedious initial parts. But if you are looking for something a little bit more all-in-one, we also do have Prometheus, also for Skyrim Special Edition. This is a pretty good, like, hey, I want to play modded Skyrim, but maybe not something that's super hardcore like Ultimate Skyrim, like where you could run around and survive a couple of shots. This also does have a graphical focus, so there's going to be a lot of texture or visual overhaul mods included with this one. And I would actually argue, out of pretty much all of the options out there right now, this is probably one of the best kind of introductory. Like, hey, I want to play pretty modded Skyrim, like a heavy load order, but not not that it feels totally different. It feels unique because it's heavily modded, but not a totally different game or ridiculously hard. If you're on the fence about this or just wanted to try something out, I would probably push you in this direction. That's just a look at a couple of the new ones. There are a few others that are still a work in progress, a few others I just didn't talk about that you can find linked down below on the Wabbajack Discord, one of which is kind of an HD version of Oblivion. I was going to cover that, but I don't actually own Oblivion and it's $20 on Steam, and I figure for the minute of gameplay I'd show, I'd just verbally describe it to you and show Skyrim rather than buying it and installing it. But yeah, this tool has really expanded since my first coverage of it. If you saw my initial video and just wrote it off, I would definitely give it a second look. A lot has been patched, a lot has been improved, and there's just a lot more options now, especially for those of you that were already pretty avid modders for these games and were just looking for a tool to make things a little bit easier. Unfortunately, there still is only one pack for Fallout 4. I would love to see some more in that category, but we just have to wait and see. I'm sure more stuff will come as this tool becomes increasingly popular, which it seemingly will become increasingly popular. Either way, that's pretty much going to wrap it up for this one. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this down below. Do you like this tool? Obviously, most users will, but how do you feel about some of the drama? Do you feel like these mod authors and mod pack guide creators are actually justified in pulling some of their content? Do you feel like it's an overreaction by them? And even more importantly, do you think we see more of this? Do you think as these tools become larger and larger, maybe some of the issues start to arise with more novice users creating them, that more people become frustrated and want to move on? Either way, again, that's going to wrap it up for this one. And with that, I hope to see you all next time. Later.